Hello everybody, I'm Professor Chandana Goswami from Tejpur University, and today I will be discussing on financing current assets. So when we use the word current assets, we divide it into two parts. One is the permanent current assets and the other is the temporary current assets. And as a finance manager, our job is to understand what kind of finance should we use for current assets. Although current assets have a period of less than 1 year, we still divide them into two parts, a permanent and a temporary. Permanent current assets is that amount which has to be maintained throughout the year. It therefore almost feels like a constant requirement. So here the requirement of working capital is a known fixed amount. Temporary current assets is the amount that is required to meet sudden unexpected demands or seasonal variations. So therefore this can fluctuate throughout the year. So here the requirement of working capital also fluctuates. We have three strategies. We will go through them one by one. Strategy A. Here we use long-term finance for not only for the fixed assets but also the peak working capital requirements, which means that you have to make an estimate of your total working capital during the year and find out what is the maximum level which is required, and you will use long-term finance for that maximum level of working capital requirement. Therefore, you can meet your requirements throughout the year from this long-term finance. Hence, no short-term finance is used. Instead, you will have surplus available at times because you have already borrowed at the highest level. So, when this surplus is available, you will invest it in liquid assets. So, this is almost like the conservative strategy. This is strategy A. We will look at strategy C, which is the other end. Here you will use long-term finance for fixed assets and the permanent working capital. So the amount that you borrow from long-term sources is enough to meet the permanent working capital. Therefore, you will need to borrow short-term finance for the temporary part. So, short-term finance is used for the fluctuating requirements. And in such a scenario, you will not have any surplus funds available with you at any point of time. So, this is the aggressive policy. Most managers may not be very comfortable with this one. So, therefore, they adopt a middle path. This is strategy B. Here you will use long-term finance for fixed assets, the permanent working capital, and a part of the temporary working capital, which keeps on fluctuating. So there are going to be months in which you will have the temporary working capital requirement going up, for which you will borrow. You will use short-term finance for these seasonal upswings. But then there are going to be months when you will not require so much of working capital to meet the fluctuating part. Therefore, you will have surplus available, and this surplus can be invested in liquid assets. Therefore, as a finance manager, you have these three options available for you. As mentioned, strategy A is in tune with the conservative working capital policy, and strategy C is in tune with the aggressive working capital policy. Let me also explain what is an operating cycle and what is a cash cycle. If you can understand this, you will be able to appreciate the need for working capital. Suppose there is a manufacturing firm which has already placed an order to the supplier. So in a few days, the stock arrives to this factory along with an invoice. Invoice is this bill. Now this stock is kept in the godown, the warehouse, where it is converted into work in process and where it finally gets converted into finished goods. The finished goods are sold in the market, and then because it is a credit sales, it takes some time before the cash is finally received. In the meantime, the company has taken up the invoice and the bill has to be paid. So therefore, the bill is paid to the supplier. The time gap between the arrival of the stock and till the finished goods, the stock arrival and finished goods, this part is known as the inventory period. Then the finished goods are sold on credit, and after some days the cash is received. This part is known as the accounts receivable period. You also have a difference out here in terms of days. The day the invoice is received, that is the bill which has come, to the day it is paid, cash is paid. This part is known as the accounts payable period. And finally, the time difference between the cash received from sales and the cash paid to the supplier is referred to as the cash cycle. Alright, and the total from this total time that is taken from the arrival of the stock to the cash received after the sales is referred to as an operating cycle. This operating cycle is measured in number of days, so it is a positive number, so you will have operating cycle measured in days, and similarly your cash cycle also is measured in days. But there is a variation. Let's have a look at the e-commerce sites. In the e-commerce site, when we place the order is received by the e-commerce site and we make our payment then and there. So therefore, the cash is received by the e-commerce site from the customer immediately. There is no question of an accounts receivable period out here. In fact, it is negative. This e-commerce site informs the supplier and the supplier dispatches the stock to the customer. So there is no inventory period for the e-commerce site. After the stock is dispatched, the supplier sends a bill to the e-commerce site and then cash is paid by the e-commerce site to the supplier. So this is an example of a negative cash cycle. You can now very well appreciate that in the former example, this has a higher requirement of working capital as compared to this one. This example does not require any working capital. So with this I conclude. Thank you very much.